Good morning. Good to see you today. Glad you decided to join us this morning. We just welcome you. Looking good out there. Now, just a couple words of announcement. Tonight we have Sunday School's teachers meeting at 5 o'clock down in near the Family Life Center, a room off there. There will be a senior adult lunch coming up on March 8th. It'll be in the Family Life Center. The deacons will be putting that on. And if you haven't signed up yet, please do that as soon as possible. Also, you'll notice on here something coming up on Saturday. And I'm going to have Dave come here and kind of explain a little bit about that to you. I lost that.
A few weeks ago, I came up and I was talking about the life skills classes that we were going to try to get going on inside the church. People filled out their forms, and some of the people have chose gardening. And as everybody knows, we're kind of entering that time of year where it's time to get the garden started and start thinking about what we're going to plant. Okay, so we've got approval from the church that we can put a garden back towards the bus garage area. So we're going to do an informational meeting next Saturday at 2 o'clock to find out what type of garden, what size of garden, what we would like to do, okay? If you have gardening skills and you would like to pass them on to somebody, we need you. If you don't know a thing about gardening, we need you. Anybody that wants to do something, whether it's with vegetable gardening, flower gardening, whichever we have, this is what's going to be decided at that meeting. So the amount of people that show up is going to decide on what type, what size, what kind, and how in-depth we become with the gardening. So anybody that's interested in that, come next Saturday at 2 o'clock. If we raise any produce out of the garden that we can use as in witnessing skills, you know, if somebody's going out, it's always nice to take produce, but I also had people that filled out that they would like to know how to do canning and cooking. So if there's something that we're growing in the garden and we want to use it as a canning skills, we'll do that later on in the summer and fall. So those are that's our first life skills that we're going to try to kick off. So if anybody's interested, 2 o'clock next Saturday. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you, Dave. Just one other thing. I'm glad you're here. If you would, if you're a guest with us today, if you would tear that off and fill it out and drop it in the offering plate when it comes by in a few minutes. If you would, let's say a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we do come to you this morning and we worship you. You're worthy to be worshiped today. And so, Lord, we ask that during this time today as we sing to you and we celebrate what you've done for us, God, we just ask that you'd burn that in our hearts and that we'd live with that each day. So, Lord, now we just ask as we continue to in this service, God, that you would just bless this time. And we pray this in your name. Amen. So at this time, if you would, if you'd stand and greet those right around you, tell them you're glad to see them this morning. You think it was good? I was trying to be a little passionate about it. It's good stuff.
It's good.
Yeah. Hey. You like it?
Yes.
Yeah. I will. I'll say something about it.
Is wonderful. His name is wonderful.
Celebration ringers ring again. I say rejoice.
Strong in the Lord.
my Savior, to take up the cross, willing to suffer reproaches and loss, willing to follow if thou wilt but lead. Only support me with grace in my need. Master, you to sing with us in just a little bit. Holy is He. You may be seated. Our ushers are going to come forward to receive the morning offering.
Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are able to gather here in worship of you. Lord, the bell choir coming up this morning, the choir singing, the hymns that we've sang this morning. Lord, we hope that you have been blessed by the things we offer to you, Lord. We feel blessed by giving them to you. Dear Heavenly Father, please be with Joe, as he brings us this message here in a little bit, may he have your word flow through him into our hearts so that we can take it out and share it with others and get to know you better. Dear Heavenly Father, please, as we come to this time, that we give just a portion, small portion of the many blessings that you've given to us, Lord. Please help it further your kingdom. Watch over us, keep us safe, keep us healthy, help us live in your example. In your heavenly name I pray. Amen.
Well, thank you very much, Celebration Ringers. Y'all did a great job this morning. Now, if you've got your Bibles, go ahead and open them up to the book of Genesis. That's where we'll be this morning. Now, let me tell you, if you missed last week, let me tell you where we are and what we're doing, and then we'll jump into this. We are in a study called This is War, and we're talking about spiritual warfare. And as I was looking at this, I was thinking about, okay, how can I introduce this? I was thinking, how many of you like the channel called History Channel? Anybody watch that? I like it. And one of the reasons why I like it, it has a lot of war shows on it, you know, about World War II. About every third show is about World War II or something. So it's pretty good. I like it. Interested. The one I was watching, though, was about, it was the very first episode in this series on World War II. And they had Franklin Delano Roosevelt up there, and he was talking to the country. It was right after the bombing of Pearl Harbor. And he gets up there and he tells the country, he says, this will be a day that live in what? Infamy, right. He said that, and then he goes on to explain that America was really already at war. And what he was doing, he was going to Congress and he was asking for a formal declaration of war. And what I want to say to you this morning is this. I'm not the president. I don't look like president. I don't have that good of hair like the president, right? But I want to make a declaration to you today. You and I are at war, right? We're at war. We're engaged in the mother of all battles. We are. And there's not been a war that can compare to this battle ever. And the war I'm talking about is spiritual warfare that started the day that you and I became a Christian. The day that we were saved, we get into the battle. And this war that we're going to talk about, we're going to be talking about for the next several weeks, affects every area of your life, every single part of your life. There's no way you can get out of this conflict. You can't get in a foxhole. You can't find a ditch to jump in. There's nowhere to go where you're not going to be a part of this war, right? And spiritual warfare is that conflict that is being waged in the invisible spiritual realm that affects the physical realm, right? And so we've talked a little bit about that. And last week we started with this. Last week we started to look at the war. And the war, one of the questions we asked was, how did it start? Where did this war start? And what we said is it all started in heaven. The whole war started in heaven. Satan looked at himself in the mirror one day and thought, you know what? Everybody ought to follow me. Look at me. I'm the best. I'm better than everything. You know, I'll take the place of God. So he let his pride get in the way, and he wanted to raise his throne above the throne of God. And so he fell, and he took a third of the angels with him. In fact, Revelation 12 says it like this. Now war arose in heaven, and Michael and his angels are fighting against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought back, but he was defeated. And there was no longer any place for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who's called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. And he was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. So listen, we know it started. An angel started it. His name was Satan, or Lucifer, we talked about last week. And he battles with God's angels, and he's thrown out of heaven. And he didn't walk out like, I guess I'll go now. No, the Bible says that Michael and the angels threw him out. And they throw him to the earth. And since they rebelled, here's what you need to know. Not only did they rebel, but they want to get us in their rebellion. That's the plan. And that brings us to today. Because today we looked at where the war started in heaven. But then it comes to the earth because Satan is thrown down to the earth. And so now we're going to look at how it started on earth. Now, if you have your Bible, Genesis chapter 1, we'll start in verse 26. I just want to point one or two things out to you, and then we'll move on from there. God created everything. That's what Genesis 1 says. And when you get down to verse 26, it's going to talk about that God created man. Here's what it says, verse 26 of chapter 1 of Genesis. Let us make man in our image, and after our likeness, and let them have dominion, which means rule, over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created him. And it says, male and female, he created them. And by the way, this isn't really in the sermon, but I just feel compelled to tell you this. All right, it says here that God created a man, and he created a male, and he created a female. He did not create them on a spectrum. A person on a spectrum that gets to just choose. He didn't create them a non-binary person. Okay? He created a male, and he created a male, and he created a female. That's it. There's not some in between. There's males and there's females. Well, you say, well, Joe, I'm offended. Well, I'm sorry. Take it up with God. He's offended that you're offended. All right? Now, verse 28. That was all free. It wasn't even in my sermon. And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it. And have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And when God created man, he gave him responsibility, y'all. And he gave him power to take charge of the earth. And this is really amazing. See, if they would put their trust and their faith and obey God, then everything was going to go good. God would help them make that place a true paradise. See, every political party promises you a paradise if they get in there. Every one of them. Now, you want to know where paradise was? It was in Genesis 1. This is it. And God says, if you'll trust me and if you'll obey me, then you'll have a paradise. And how awesome this was. They were going to be in charge of everything on the earth, and they were going to be living in just this true paradise. Trees, fruit, not having to worry about what everybody's wearing, because they weren't wearing nothing. They were naked. And no sin, no selfishness, no fighting, no Democrats or Republicans. It was a great world. And Adam and Eve would be in charge of everything. Now imagine how incredible that was, how good a paradise that was. And then imagine Satan. He's ticked off. He's been kicked out of heaven. And he's down to earth now. And he would like to be in charge of this whole thing. Right? And if he can't rule, then he wants to burn the place down and take as many people with him. So that's where the war starts. Genesis chapter 1. And then, so God makes Adam and Eve. And he gives them all this freedom, but he gives them one command to see if they're going to be willing to obey. Here's the command. Turn to the next chapter, chapter 2, verses 16 and 17. Here's what it says. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for the day that you eat of it, you'll surely die. And in this command right here, God gave them freedom to choose obedience or disobedience, right? It's the choice between God's will and their own will. Then we get to chapter 3. Now, chapter 3 is one of the most important chapters of the Bible. We've covered it several times. But it is so important. Explains why the world is the way it is, and actually even gives a solution. And again, as we get ready to read this, the scene is a beautiful garden, right? Everything's good, everything's perfect, and God has the first parents, our parents, and they're living in this perfect setting without any sin and all its effects. And so here we go, Genesis 3:1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden. But God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that's in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. But the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die. For God knows when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Now again, here's my first question. When you read this, who's the serpent? Who is the serpent here, right? And we know this, that the serpent is Satan. Because remember what we read in Revelation 12? Let me just remind you, it says the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who was called the devil and Satan. That's him. So this is an angel, Satan, and here he is. He slithered up to the first man and woman, and look what it says about him. It says that he was crafty. And it says actually that he was more crafty than any beast of the field. In other words, the idea there is sneaky and subtle. And what this means, y'all, is Satan is smarter than you are. And you say, well, Joe, I don't think so. Well, I just proved it to you right there. He's smarter than all of us. And here's the other thing. He has a plan for you and I. So you better have a plan. Because Satan's got a plan. And I'll tell you what, in fact, 2 Corinthians 2:11 says that Satan, it warns the Christians in Corinth that's not to be outsmart by Satan. It says, because we're familiar with his evil schemes. Again, there's a war going on between God and his angels and the devil and his angels. Right? Now, Satan is not equal with God. God lets his angels do his business. He doesn't even mess with him because all he'd have to do is go bing and it's over. Right? And so what the devil's plan is, though, he wants us to participate in his rebellion against God. That's his plan for you, is to get you to rebel. Now, Satan just shows up, and this is what you got to understand. So we talk about spiritual warfare. Satan's not invited to the party with the man and the woman. He just shows up. And demons and Satan will just show up in your life. Right? And he hopes. And by the way, some of you are like, well, I don't know why I deserve this. You see things in your life fall apart. Maybe getting here this morning was a struggle for you. I know lots of people say, I don't know. You know, I have a great week Monday through Saturday, then get to Sunday, and I don't even understand. But it's such a struggle to get to church. You know why? It's called spiritual warfare. Right? And Satan just shows up, and he's not invited, and he hopes that you'll have a conversation with him. That's what he hopes. And when you read this story, he shows up, and he shows up in a disguise. He doesn't show up. When it comes to Satan, he's not going to show up and be a coiled snake for you. He's not going to have a red light saying, hey, it's Satan. He's not going to put a shirt with it on the back of his shirt where it says his name, Satan. He's just going to show up. Right? And he's just going to slide in your life, and there's going to be nothing to really call attention to him that you're going to dread. The New Testament calls him this. The New Testament calls him an angel of light. Going to sound kind of good. See, he doesn't come knocking on your door and say, hey, I'd like to ruin your life and destroy you. He doesn't start with that. See, Eve has no idea what's about to happen to her. Right? She didn't know that. She didn't say, well, you know what? I better have an extra long quiet time today because today there's going to be this tempter, this snake come up to me. And if I give in, it's going to be heartache, it's going to be trouble, it's going to be murder, it's going to be the mayhem and hatred of every form to billions of people from now on. None of that happens. Right? He just shows up. And you know, here's what he does. He questions God's word. Look at the first thing he says. He says this to her. He says, indeed, depending on your version, has God said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden? I'm shocked. Now, we just looked at the command a few minutes ago in Genesis chapter 2, and God didn't say that at all. Did God say they couldn't eat of any tree? No. He said that you could eat from every tree except for one. Just one. And what Satan does in this conversation is he tries to get the woman to laser focus on that one tree. Not all the other trees. Now, what's he up to here? What he wants to do is he wants to put doubt in this woman's mind. He wants her to doubt God's goodness. See, God had said, Adam and Eve, you can eat freely of any of the trees in the garden except one. Satan never brings up the vastness of God's goodness about all the trees. Just the one. He just wants to misrepresent God. That's all he's about here. And here's the truth. He wants to show him as basically a not a good God. And here's the thing. God is a gracious God, right? And when he says no, he has a reason for saying no to something, right? It's kind of like the parent who stocks the fridge, stocks the pantry, puts it all in there and says, hey, I got one rule. Don't drink out of the toilet. That's the only thing. Just don't drink out of the toilet. Drink. There's lots of stuff in the fridge. Just get one of those. See, here's my question. How does the enemy still use that strategy today? Why don't you think about this? What's your forbidden fruit? Everybody has one. I'm not asking you to scream it out. Let me pick on the easy, obvious one. How about sex? I was thinking about this in the first service because I didn't really plan out my example here, but think about sex for a second. God says sex is for, in the context of marriage, is where it ought to happen. Outside of that, it's always, always wrong. Now, does God do that because he is a mean, God who just wants to ruin everybody's fun? No. He knows what kind of damage it does to people. He's the one that, it's his idea. Right? And so, but what does the devil say? No, man, it feels good. You got to do it. What do they tell our kids today? Oh, just if it feels good, do it. You just got to do it. Today, if you were to say that sex is for just for marriage, and you go around and you tell the kids that, you know what they're going to do? They're going to laugh at you and say, oh, well, I'm going to live with someone for a while and make sure it's all right before I do this. That's old Christianity stuff. Our God's not like that. All they do is they try to really put God as a mean God. Now, if you're experiencing any of that, and I could give you 100 examples, here's the thing. You're experiencing spiritual warfare, because that's exactly what that is, spiritual warfare. So first thing he does is he wants the woman to doubt God's goodness. And then he's going to secondly deny God's word. Look at verse 4. Genesis 4, the serpent said to the woman, you shall surely not die. So he lies to her. And by the way, the devil is the father of lies. And he hadn't changed a bit. See, what questioning and doubts do is bring about denial in the end, right? And if Eve had not listened to the Satan here in the very beginning, he wouldn't be victimized by her later. He wouldn't be denying God's word. Now, here's what Satan does. Satan starts with a denial. And you know what he denies? The doctrine of judgment. He starts with that. Listen, what God said, you will certainly die when you eat it. What did the devil say? You will not die. Right? So why does he go with that doctrine over all the others? And the answer is pretty simple. If you're convinced that you can get away with sin, sooner or later you're going to do it. That's how it is. Right? If you think no one will know, no one's ever going to notice about it, no one's going to call you on account for it, then you'll do it. That's what Satan knows. And then, so what he does, he goes from doubt to denial. Then he sticks his own lie in there. And look at verse 5. For God knows that in the day you eat up from it, your eyes will be open, and you'll be like God, knowing good and evil. And this final enticement is really, really powerful, right? Because it's the same thing that got Satan. Really, Satan said, you'll be like, he took the lie, you will be like God. And he fed it to Eve. And Eve thought, oh, this sounds pretty good. In other words, the devil was saying, let me tell you what God is doing here. He doesn't want you to know something. He doesn't want you to be like him. He knows if you do this, then you'll be like him. By the way, isn't that what some religions teach? Mormonism? Oh, you get your own planet. And you'll be your own God on that planet. All you got to do, check it out if you think I'm one. Hinduism, oh, you'll have all these karmas. And you keep coming back to something else. If you're good, you keep working yourself up, and finally you'll be a part of the God, Nirvana. Right? Over and over, they teach this. Now listen, we are on the back side of that lie. Does anybody here feel like a God? It's just a lie. And here's the truth. If you believe a lie, it will ruin your life. Right? The devil's like, well, and I'll tell you, the answer is in that tree. Just take a bite of that fruit, and you'll know what God knows. So here's what happens. Look at verse 6. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. And at that moment, y'all, listen to me. At that moment, the battle was lost, just like that. Right? Satan wanted control of the human race, and he got it right there. Sin entered the world, and humanity was lost. And you look around, and listen, we see all the devastation that this has caused. All you got to do is watch the news. You know, there wouldn't have, if this had never happened, there would be no coronavirus. And I could keep going. We wouldn't need Dateline TV to tell us about all the bad murders and all the things. Right? And here's what I want you to know. Humanity lost the war to Satan. We lost our war. And then look at verse 7. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. And they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and the woman hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" And I just want to pause right here and offend men for a minute. Because, listen to me. Satan will lead your family if the man won't. You say, what are you talking about? See, God asks the men, he's asking, where are you? Where are you, Adam? And he asks the same thing to every man sitting in here. Where are you? Are you doing your God-given responsibility of leading your family? The lesson from our first father is this. If men don't lead their homes, then the devil will. That's what happened. Go back and read that. I found this kind of interesting. I don't have time to really do a lot with this, but I'll just tell you this. Here's the man and the woman, and you hear the story between the woman and the snake, but guess who was standing right there? The Bible says he was standing right there. He let it happen. See, he didn't lead. And here's what I would tell you. Adam should have been calling out to God, not God calling out to Adam. He should have grabbed his wife and repented right there. That's what he should have done, but he didn't do it. Genesis 3:10. I heard the sound of you. God asked where you are, Adam, and here's what he said. I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself. And by the way, before this, there never was fear. This is the first mention of fear. And there was no such thing as fear before this. And then he says, I was naked. And by the way, that has to do with you have guilt because you sin, and then you have shame. And when we have shame because of what we've done, we want to hide. So you had shame. And then you had death. And death, y'all, is just this, according to the Bible. It's just separation. And we have a physical separation that happens when we die, but there's also a spiritual separation that happens with our relationship with God. Right? Adam, now this is very important, you got to understand this. Adam was the representative and the father of all mankind. And when he sinned, so did every person who had ever lived. Who would ever live after him, I guess is the best way. One of the great demonic myths is this, is that each of us is an isolated individual and we're born into this world with a blank slate and we're able to determine our own destiny. The fact is, each of us is born on the wrong side of the war. Right? And when Adam sinned, he voted for all humanity. And here's what Romans 5 says it like this. Sin came into the world through one man. That man was Adam. And death through sin, and so death spread to all mankind because all have sinned. And right there, the war's lost, we lost our war, and we're in trouble. Right? And by the way, that's all bad news, isn't it? That's not good stuff. Ultimately, here's what we do. Because the problem came from the outside down to earth, now we need a solution that's outside of us, something outside of us, right? So let me give you the good news, because we just hit the bad news. We need something to help, somebody or something to help us win this war, because we can't win it. On the same day that all this stuff goes down, some good news happened, right? God made a promise. After cursing Adam and Eve, and I just want to skip to verse 15. Look at verse 15. God says this, I will put enmity between you, talking about Satan, and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring, and he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. And theologians have called this promise right here in verse 15, this is the promise of Jesus' coming. It's called the first gospel. It's the first mention of the gospel. And here's the thing, that's the first mention of it, and that's God himself telling it. At the very end of time, before eternity's rushed in, there's going to be an angel who's going to preach it out one last time. And in between that and that, God and the angels and us get to be involved in proclaiming the true gospel of Jesus Christ, right? And here's the true gospel. Jesus Christ is the victorious king who was born the God-man. In other words, he was born by the Holy Spirit. Through the power of the Holy Spirit and Mary, right? And he comes and he lived a perfect life. And while he's here on earth, he's spiritually attacked. The first spiritual attack that we know of was when Herod wanted to kill all the boys. You know who was behind that? The real power was the devil. But God protects him and takes him to Egypt. Jesus grows up, still lived a perfect life, and he gets to the time of his ministry, and he goes into the wilderness for 40 days, and he doesn't eat or drink anything for 40 days. And guess who shows up? The devil. And Jesus conquered him all the way to the cross, right? Where Jesus was tempted to have the cross taken away and have a crown without the cross. And you all know that. And through the cross, Satan and the demons, while Jesus is hanging there, they said, we finally got the king. We finally got him. See, while Jesus was there, if you can just picture the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross bleeding and dying. And the devil just sitting there going, giving high fives. Yeah, we got him this time, boys. This is over. Right? And I love this because Isaiah says that truly, Isaiah 45 verse 15 says, truly you're a God who hides himself. And on the cross, Jesus hid his victory in defeat. On the cross, Jesus bled and died and for you and I. And then in the final moments of the cross, right before he dies, while he's hanging there, he says this, and it rang through eternity. It is finished. And it was done. And victory was won. Right there. Crucifying Jesus, by the way, 1 Corinthians says was the biggest mistake that the devil ever made. In fact, it says this, none of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would have not crucified the Lord of glory. And one of the most powerful scriptures about Jesus' victory over sin and Satan is this, Colossians 2:13-15. And let me read it to you. And you who were dead in your trespasses, and uncircumcised of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with all its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and the authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. And Jesus came and he crushed the head of the snake. Right? And he came to defeat Satan and set us all free. And one day, y'all, there's going to be one final defeat. Right? When Jesus comes as our hero, the last time, and he sets everything right. And by the way, our culture gets this. I don't know if you've ever watched a Marvel movie, but our culture gets this. We have all these stories, and let me just give you one example. It's the story of mankind where over and over again, that what you see is humanity's in trouble. There's this power out there. Every superhero movie, there's this power out there that man can't defeat. They can't stop the enemy. They can't beat him. They need somebody beyond their power. So there's this superhero that comes along. Batman, Superman, Aquaman, whoever, I can't even think of them all right now, whoever, you name them. All these superheroes with superpowers, and they defeat the enemy. And here's the thing. All of those movies should give God royalties, because God is the one who actually did that and came up with that idea, because that was his plan. And that's why we vibe with that. That's why we get that. We need a superhero to save us. And we got it, Jesus. Now, what does that mean for you? That means the devil and his demons have no legal authority over you anymore. If you're a believer in Jesus, that's what's true of you. Right? They may take advantage of your sin, of your folly, of your unbelief, of your fear and all those things. But here's the thing. Their ownership, their dominion, their condemnation has no more rule in your life. And I'll say this. For those of you that, if you belong to Jesus Christ today, all the demonic ties that have been formed from the time you were little, through sin, through cultic ritual, there's people that have that, through generational sin, and let me just put some legs to this. Generational sin is goes like this. God wants to bless families. Satan always wants to counterfeit. And what God blesses, Satan wants to turn around and curse. And so what Satan does, when God wants to bless families, Satan wants to curse families. And so you'll have things in families like alcoholism, infidelity. I can go through a whole list of different things. And what you'll notice is in families over and over again, you'll see the same things happen over. You see one alcoholism here, and then you'll see it again. And it'll just keep going over and over. And people think, well, that's just our family. That's just this. No, that's a generational, that's really a generational sin. Right? And what I'll tell you is this, is all of those things, according to the Bible, were rendered null and void by virtue of the complete and the total victory of Jesus Christ at the cross. That's how big a deal this is. I know you're sleeping, you're tired, whatever, but your job is to believe that and claim that and live it. Right? See, because the Bible says this, if the Son sets you free, you're free indeed. Have you been set free by the Son? Then you're free indeed. Lastly, let me just say this. Let me end by giving you Charles Spurgeon, one of the great preachers of all time. He describes this battle and what happened with Jesus. I just want to read it to you real quick. Satan came against Christ. He had in his hand a sharp sword called the law, dipped in the poison of sin, so that every wound which the law inflicted was deadly. Christ grabbed the sword out of Satan's hand, and there stood the prince of darkness unarmed. His helmet was split in two, and his head was crushed with a rod of iron. Then death rose against Christ. The Savior snatched his quiver from him, emptied out all his darts, cut them in two, gave death back the feather end, and kept the poison barbs from him that he might never destroy the ransomed. Then sin came against Christ, but sin was utterly cut in pieces. See, all of our enemies, yours and mine, have been totally disarmed, and Satan has nothing left him to attack you. And then lastly, the crown. The crown was taken off Satan's head, and his reigning power is gone. Now, he may tempt you, but he cannot compel, and he may threaten, but he cannot subdue. So let us not fear. The result of the battle is certain. So do not be afraid when the evil one comes at you. Be courageous, remembering that you have a fight with a stingless dragon. He may hiss, but his teeth are broken and his poison fangs are extracted. You have to do battle with an enemy already scarred by your master's weapon, so be not afraid. The enemy may rush at you with his hideous noise and terrible alarms, but there is no real cause of fear. Stand fast in the Lord. Jesus won. Amen. And that's what we celebrate today, is the fact that Jesus won. That's why you're here. Now listen to me. We're going to come to an invitation time, and here's the invitation. See, if you're here and you've never given your life to Christ, then you're on the wrong side. And today is a call for you to be saved. Here's the second thing. If you're a Christian in here and there's something in your life that you're given, maybe you're given a foothold to the devil, today is the day, a call of repentance. God's calling you to repent. So we're going to have a time here where the altar is going to be open. If you want to come and pray, maybe you want to pray for somebody. Maybe you're not being attacked, but maybe your family is. So I want to just give you an opportunity to respond. Maybe you're here and you need to join this church. Maybe you need to be baptized. Whatever it is, we want to give you an opportunity to do that. So as we pray, would you bow with me? We're going to bring this to the Lord. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we come to you this morning. And Lord, we celebrate your victory. I pray for every believer in here, Lord, that we would claim your victory in our lives. God, and if there is an area that we've given Satan a foothold, God, that we would repent of that we would confess it and get right. Lord, we ask that you have your way right now in this service, and we ask this in your name, amen. So I'm going to ask you, if you would, to stand with me. As you come to this time in the service, we just want to give you an opportunity to respond. So the altar is here if you want to come and pray. You want someone to pray with you. Maybe you want to pray for somebody in your family. Whatever God's leading you to do right now, you do as Kevin leads. Amen. I pray that you have a great afternoon, and that maybe you can go out and share some of God's good news. You know, there's a hurt world out there that's being attacked. And so let's pray for our church, pray for those outside, that we reach this community for the Lord. We want to see darkness push back. Amen. All right. Let me see who's praying. Chuck, if you would come and close us out today.
Let us pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this powerful message that you've given Brother Joe to speak through you. And we just thank you, Lord, that we can take this message and that we can claim the victory of our sins through Jesus Christ our Lord. We ask, Lord, that you just be with us now as we go throughout the rest of this day and this week, that you would guide us and direct us in the things that we do. Thank you so much for all the many, many blessings you've given us in our lives. And I ask you, Lord, to forgive us when and where we fail you. For I ask these things in Jesus' name, for his sake. Amen.